As an architect, I am always intrigued by the concept of a dome over the flat earth with water above it. I could hardly imagine that such a construction ever could be made, other than by magic or by
the majesty of the heavens.
During my study at the University of Delft, I spent much time studying construction principles and I learned to calculate, in general terms, the necessary strength of construction components. However, the construction of domes was only a very small part of the curriculum. So I had to study the principles of calculating the strength of a dome again. I soon lost my way into calculus formulas, something I had learned 50 years ago, but my knowledge about calculus has become a little rusty, to put it mildly. So I decided to simplify the matter considerably. First, let me explain some basic things about domes. In general, architects try to make their constructions such that they are mostly subjected to compression forces rather than to tensile forces. Most building materials, steel is an exception, have a very high compression resistance but a very weak tensile resistance. To show how a perfect dome would be designed, I used this necklace of my wife. When hung on both ends, it takes a particular shape. Because the thread can take no compression forces whatsoever, the necklace is subjected only to tensile forces. The particular shape is called a chain line. This principle dates from the time of Christiaan Huygens, who was the first to describe it. The shape is close to a parabola, but not exactly. When you change the ratio between the height and the width of the chain line, you change the forces in the chain. The smaller this ratio, the higher the forces. Now, if you turn this picture upside down, the tensile forces have become compression forces, and you have the ideal form of a dome. This principle was used, among others, by Antoni Gaudí when he designed the famous Sagrada Familia in Barcelona. Imagine a dome in the form of half a sphere and imagine its cross-section consists of parts of 1 meter. Then each section of 1 meter is slightly twisted relative to its neighbor. Now, since the top meter deviates only very little from horizontal, a vertical force on that part would result in a considerable slanting force component and a considerable horizontal force component. The larger the dome, the smaller the angle to horizontal of the first meter at the top. Let's assume that the flat earth dome has a radius of 20,000 kilometers. This is twice the known distance from equator to each of the poles. This means that the cross-section of the dome would have a length of 62,832 kilometers, which would imply that each section of 1 meter would have an angle of 0.0000286 degrees relative to its neighbor. Now let's assume that at the top the water above the dome would be 100 meters high. This would mean that a cylinder with a radius of 1 meter would weigh 314,160 kilograms. Now you can calculate the slanting and the horizontal component of the resulting forces. They turn out to be 6,280,000,000,000 kilograms for both the slanting and the horizontal component. I know I should use newtons as the unit for force, but then the numbers would be even higher, so I'll stick to kilograms. Now most flat earthers do adhere to the idea of a dome that is made of some sort of glass or crystal. Glass is one of the most compression resilient materials in the world, stronger than steel or concrete, stronger even than diamond, one of the hardest but at the same time one of the brittlest materials. Glass can take a pressure of 71 kilograms per square millimeter, so it's pretty strong. But still, to be able to cope with that 6.2 trillion kilograms of force, it needs to be around 14 kilometers thick, which in turn would weigh in itself 110 million kilograms, which adds to the total load on the first meter on the top of the dome. The second section of 1 meter would have to take a load of 12,566,370 kilograms, resulting in a pressure force of over 12 trillion kilograms. This would require a thickness of glass of over 18 kilometers, a thickness that would add another 146 million kilograms to the load. I'll ignore that the tensile strength of glass is only 1/10 of its compressive strength. So, with the thicknesses calculated on the pressure forces, the tension forces, those are the horizontal components of the load, would make the whole thing explode long before it would have collapsed under the compression. Well, a flat earther might say, your dimensions are totally wrong, we don't know the dimensions of the flat earth. But the flat earth must have dimension of some sort. Let's assume the radius of the flat earth could only be 6,000 kilometers. In that case, the required thickness of the first meter would have to be only 4.2 kilometers, and that of the second meter only 5.6 kilometers. No, 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 others would claim there is no water above the dome. Okay, let's assume a load of only 1 kilogram. Then the thickness of the first meter would have to be only 0.01 meter, but the weight of the first and the second meter alone would add over 290 kilograms to the load, resulting in an additional 3 meter of thickness, which in itself adds over 50,000 kilograms to the load, which would need 756 meter extra thickness, which would in turn increase the load to over 12 million kilograms, and so on and so further. You see where this is going. There is no material strong enough to hold itself up over a radius of 6,000 kilometers under the load of its own weight alone. And then, those 6,000 kilometers is a conservative estimation. To top it off, there are models of the flat earth dome I have seen that are not semicircular, but are a flattened semicircle. The forces in such a very unfavorable construction would be even higher than I calculated here. I know enough. There is no construction possible that humans, with all their ingenuity, could come up with that would make a dome as proposed by the flat earthers even remotely feasible. So yes, so you have to believe in
the majesty of the heavens
and invoke some magic. But most of all, you have to have a lack of basic knowledge of architectural design and construction methods.